Hello, I'm Doug Puckett, pastor and rector of St. Paul's Episcopal Church, Graniteville, South Carolina. And in this time of the pandemic crisis and so many churches being closed, this is the St. Paul's Episcopal Church broadcast on St. Paul's Facebook and on YouTube. Again, on behalf of St. Paul's, we thank the Langley Church of God and its pastor, Eddie Hardy, for making this broadcast possible and for the use of the equipment. Again, please note, our church treasurer, Steve Peterson, and indeed our entire lay leadership of St. Paul's, continues to remind our listening members to help keep St. Paul's stable financially during this time of crisis. It looks like it will be sometime in late June before we can go back to St. Paul's Church again, at least late June. This is by direction of our bishop, and indeed all the bishops of the Episcopal Church across the United States. All the Episcopal churches are going to be closed until then. And so, because we're continuing to be closed and we're continuing to have to do these type of broadcasts, continue to send your tithe in the mail to St. Paul's Episcopal Church's address, P.O. Box 276, Graniteville, South Carolina, 29829. Thanks to all who have continued to tithe during this period. Believe me, it is really helping. And some of you have given rather generously, I might add. Another announcement which I continue to announce, hopefully for your comfort and encouragement, hopefully it's not a broken record. I want you to know that every Sunday morning by myself, I do go to St. Paul's Church and pray for you and St. Paul's. I do what is known as the daily office, which is the order of morning prayer in the church. This, of course, is a symbolic link between those of you who cannot come to these services and to St. Paul's Church. Today is the sixth Sunday of the season of Easter, and we sing as a solo to begin our service, "Mine Eyes Have Seen the Glory." Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. In the beauty of the lilies, Christ was born across the sea, with a glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us live to make all free, while God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. For those of you at home following in the Book of Common Prayer, it is the order of morning prayer beginning on page 41 in the Book of Common Prayer. We'll give you a moment to look that up. Page 41 in the Book of Common Prayer. Welcome to our service today, Sarah Sylvester and her mother, Rebecca Sylvester, along with members of the Hardy family as well. And it is indeed the Langley Episcopal Church of God this morning, at least for this service. Page 41 in the prayer book. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. O send out thy light and thy truth that they may lead me and bring me into thy holy hill and to thy dwelling. Dearly beloved, we have come together in the presence of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at His hands, to set forth His most worthy praise, to hear His holy word, and to ask for ourselves and on behalf of others those things that are necessary for our life and our salvation, and so that we may prepare ourselves in heart and mind to worship Him. Let us kneel in silence, or in our case, sit in silence or stand, and with penitent and obedient hearts, confess our sins, that we may obtain forgiveness by His infinite goodness and mercy, saying together, Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from Thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against Thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. But Thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us. Spare Thou those who confess their faults. Restore Thou those who are penitent, according to Thy promises declared unto mankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant a most merciful Father for His sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of Thy holy name. Amen. The Almighty and merciful Lord grant you absolution, remission of all your sins, true repentance, amendment of life, and the grace and consolation of His Holy Spirit.
Amen.
O Lord, open Thy lips,
and our mouth
shall show forth Thy praise. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Hallelujah, the Lord is risen indeed. Oh, come, let us adore Him.
A reading from Acts. Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, Ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things ye are too superstitious. For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, To the unknown God, whom therefore ye ignorantly worship, him declare I unto you. God that made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands, neither is worshipped with men's hands, as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth to all life and breath and all things. And hath made of one blood all nations of men for you to dwell on all the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointed and the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after him and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as certain also of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring. For as much then as we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone, graven by art and man's device. In the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent, because he hath appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given assurance unto all men in that he hath raised him from the dead. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 66, found on page 674 in your prayer book, the Psalter, the Book of Psalms, page 676 in the book, or rather 674 in the Book of Common Prayer. We'll do Psalm 66, verses 7 through 18, responsively. Bless our God, you peoples. Make the voice of his praise to be heard.
Who holds our souls in life and will not allow our feet to slip.
For you, O God, have proved us. You have tried us just as silver is tried.
You brought us into the snare. You laid heavy burdens upon our backs.
You let enemies ride over our heads. We went through fire and water, but you brought us out of a place into a place of refreshment.
I will enter your house with burnt offerings,
and will pay you my vows. which I promised with my lips and spoke with my mouth when I was in trouble. I will offer you sacrifices of fat beasts with the smoke of rams. I will give you oxen and goats.
Come and listen, all you who fear God, and I will tell you what he has done for me.
I called out to him with my mouth, and his praise was on my tongue.
If I had found evil in my heart,
the Lord would not have heard me. But in truth, God has heard me. He has attended the voice of my prayer. Blessed be God, who has not rejected my prayer, nor withheld his love from me. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of St. Matthew. Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. And 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight there were a cry made, Behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him. Then all these virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said unto the wise, Give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out. But the wise answered, saying, Not so, lest there be not enough for us and you. But go ye rather to them that sell, and buy for yourselves. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came. And they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. Afterward came also the other virgins, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered and said, Verily I say unto you, I know you not. Watch therefore, for ye know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Page 53, bottom of the page. Let us stand or sit as we may be, and let us say together and confess our faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. O Lord, show thy mercy upon us.
And grant us thy salvation.
And do thy ministers with righteousness.
And make thy chosen people joyful.
Give peace, O Lord, in all the world.
For only in thee can we live in safety.
Lord, keep this nation under thy care.
And guide us in the way of justice and truth.
Let thy way be known upon earth.
Thy saving health among all nations.
Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten.
Nor the hope of the poor be taken away.
Create in us clean hearts, O God.
And sustain us with thy Holy Spirit.
O Lord, save thy people and bless thine heritage.
Govern them and lift them
up forever.
Day by day we magnify thee.
And we worship thy name ever, world without end.
Vouchsafe, O Lord, to keep us this day without sin.
O Lord, have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us.
O Lord, let thy mercy be upon us.
As our trust is in thee.
O Lord, in thee have I trusted.
Let me never be confounded.
The colic, that is the prayer assigned for this, the sixth Sunday of the season of Easter. O God, who has prepared for those who love thee such good things as past man's understanding, pour into our hearts such love towards thee, that we, loving thee in all things and above all things, may obtain thy promises, which exceed all that we could desire, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A colic or prayer for times of plague and sickness. O Almighty God, who in thy wrath didst send a plague upon thine own people in the wilderness for their obstinate rebellion against Moses and Aaron, and also in the time of King David didst slay with a plague of pestilence 70,000, that is 70,000, and yet remembering thy mercy didst save the rest. Have pity upon us, miserable sinners, who now are visited with great sickness and mortality, that like as thou didst then accept of an atonement and didst command the destroying angel to cease from punishing, so it may now please thee to withdraw from us this plague and grievous sickness through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
O God, the King eternal, who dividest the day into the night from the night and turnest the shadow of death into the morning, drive far from us all wrong desires. Incline our hearts to keep thy law and guide our feet into the way of peace, that having done thy will with cheerfulness while it was day, we may, when the night cometh, rejoice to give thee thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, who didst stretch out thine arms of love on the hard wood of the cross, that everyone might come within the reach of thy saving embrace, so clothe us in thy Spirit, that we, reaching forth our hands in love, may bring those who do not know thee to the knowledge and love of thee, for the honor of thy name.
Amen.
Amen.
On page 58 in the prayer book, let us now render our thanks together in the words of the general thanksgiving. Together, Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we thine unworthy servants do give thee most humble and hearty thanks for all thy goodness and loving kindness to us and to all men. We bless thee for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for thine inestimable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we beseech thee, give us that due sense of all thy mercies, that our hearts may be unfeignedly thankful, and that we show forth thy praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to thy service and by walking before thee in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. Almighty God, who has given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication unto thee, and has promised thy well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, thou wilt be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of thy servants as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost be with us all evermore.
Amen.
A solo by Sarah Sylvester.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank thee for Sarah and the gift of music that has been given to her. We thank you for her faithfulness and her serving thee. We pray that all young people in all of this generation may wake up spiritually to thee and may come to thee and be restored and renewed and revived and saved, and that they may also be a people that are unto thee, a people that are righteous and who will lead the church in the next generation. We thank thee for the power of thy Holy Spirit. Touch and guide us as we seek thy face. Speak to us the word of life, that we may also be able to go forth and follow that word in our lives. And we ask this, all of this, in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Amen. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be found acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Amen. Today's sermon is on believing in an unknown God or a God we know. And as a scripture reading not read today but was one of the options in the prayer book declares, 1 Peter 3:21, sanctify the Lord God in your hearts and be ready to give an answer for the hope that is within you. Even baptism doth also now save us. So the Bible here declares the importance of a profession of faith and knowing in whom we believe. And it also talks about baptism. And what it declares here is that part of the way you and I are saved is through becoming a member of the church and being baptized. You see, Christ has no secret disciples. You can say you believe in God and Jesus Christ and the Bible all you want to, but if you're not a follower of Jesus Christ and the surrender of your life to Christ and the Holy Church, you are not accounted as a disciple or a Christian or one saved by Jesus Christ. And that's why in the Epistle of St. James, it declares chapter 2, verses 19 and 17, thou believest that there is one God, thou doest well, the devils also believe and tremble. Even so, faith, if it hath not works, is dead. In other words, if it has no commitment and surrender to Christ, our faith is dead, being alone. Too many people today, however, worship an unknown God. They assent to belief in the good man upstairs, but they have not experienced him, nor have they committed their lives to him. But in today's first reading from Acts 17, we see this phenomenon of worshiping of God who was unknown was a problem even back in Bible times 2,000 years ago. The Apostle Paul, missionary and evangelist that he was, came to Athens, Greece, and going up on Mars Hill, the Acropolis, the Areopagus section of the city, he saw many statues of many gods and goddesses as he went up the hill. Aphrodite, or as in Latin it's called Venus, and Ares or Mars, god of war, Zeus, Hercules, and so forth. And finally, he came upon an altar dedicated to any gods or any god that the Greeks may have forgotten or didn't know. The Bible says that Paul was given permission to lecture and preach before the egghead professors and scholars and leaders of the Greeks that day. But Paul said, ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are too superstitious. For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with an inscription to the unknown God. Whom therefore ye ignorantly worship, him declare I unto you. The one true God who made the world is not worshipped with man's hands. But he hath made of one blood all nations and races of men, and God hath appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, whom he hath raised from the dead. So Paul preached, the Bible says that some came to faith in Jesus Christ that day, others mocked and made fun, but some were saved and who gave their lives to Jesus. So likewise today, my friends, we must be sure we are not worshiping an unknown God, but that we have truly given our lives to Jesus Christ, who is the only way to salvation and the only one who can help us escape the wrath to come. And so again, today's sermon, worshiping an unknown God. John Oxenham once wrote a poem. It was entitled Credo, which is Latin for I believe, and the poem goes like this. Not what, but whom I do believe. That in my darkest hour of need hath comfort that no mortal creed to mortal man may give. Not whom, not what, but whom, for Christ is more than all the creeds, and his full life of gentle deeds shall all the creeds outlive. Not what I do believe, but who walks beside me in the gloom, who shares the burden wearisome, who all the dim way doth illume and bids me look beyond the tomb, the larger life to live. Not what I do believe, but whom. Not what, but whom. Now in this poem, Oxenham gives us the difference between a dead faith and a living faith. It is the difference between a true believer and one who believes in God, believes in a sense of the concept of Christ, but does not follow Christ. There's the difference between a real Christian and those who trust in dead works to save, who may indeed be baptized or believe in the doctrines of the faith, but it's hard for them to explain why they're not in church and why they do not follow Christ. Not that belief is not important. As the scripture was read earlier and from James, the devils believe and also tremble, but show me your faith without your works, and I'll show you my faith by my works, St. James says. But the question is today, are we in the faith of Jesus Christ? I pray with all my heart that we all have a living faith, not a faith of just intellectual assent, or a little baptism, or a little communion, or a little belief, but a faith of commitment and surrender of our lives to Jesus. From the youngest to the oldest, we're all equal in Jesus Christ. And I hope we have a living faith also in Jesus. Not that we are perfect, but when we do sincerely submit our lives to the Lord Jesus, the Lord will receive us and will in no wise cast out. In today's Gospel of Matthew chapter 25, Jesus once gave us the parable of the virgins, 10 bridesmaids. 5 of them were wise and 5 were foolish. And this parable, this symbolic story, teaches us about those with genuine faith and those without that kind of faith. The setting was an ancient Jewish wedding. In Jesus' day, weddings were always house weddings, but not the house of the bride, but the house of the groom. And instead of the wedding party waiting for the bride to march in, it was the groom that marched in. And the wedding was always done at night. And in rich people's homes, after the wedding, there was feasting for 3 days. And usually the invited guests just spent the several nights at the feast sleeping at the groom's house. Beds were provided for them. But the festivities and the ceremony done by a rabbi or a Jewish preacher, well, they had to wait for the groom's arrival for any of this to begin. And he did not always come at a precise hour. They didn't have watches back then. And in this case, in Jesus' story, the groom was exceptionally late. Now the 10 bridesmaids were there with their lamps lit, for this was a candlelit wedding. But the Bible says 5 of these bridesmaids were wise. They knew that weddings often started late, and so they had brought extra oil as a precaution. But the Bible also says the other 5 bridesmaids were foolish. They had not taken extra provision of oil, and their lamps went out before the groom's arrival. And they asked the 5 wise virgins to share their oil, but the 5 wise responded, "Not so, for fear that we do not have enough for the ceremony." And so the 5 foolish maids had to go back into the marketplace, wake up a shopkeeper or two, and actually cause him to open his shop back up and sell them some oil. In the meanwhile, at midnight, the groom arrived, and the doors of the house were shut and locked, and the wedding ceremony began. Then the 5 foolish bridesmaids arrived and knocked at the door of the house and said, "My Lord, open to us." But the groom from within said, "I never knew you. Depart from me." And then Jesus ended this parable and said, "Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man comes." Now there is a lot of symbolism in Jesus' story, and this is what it means. The 5 wise virgins or bridesmaids are the true Christians who have a living faith in Jesus Christ. The 5 foolish maids are those who think they had faith in Jesus, but it is not really a genuine faith. The oil and the lit lamps represents the faith of Jesus that is within us. The wedding ceremony and the wedding feast represents heaven. And the groom's arrival represents the second coming of Christ. The foolish maids are professing Christians who really do not have a living faith in Jesus Christ. Their faith is weak and shallow, and it is not enough to sustain them their whole life through. So like the bridesmaids whose lamps extinguished before the Lord's coming, so these are easy to drift away from God, or put their faith on a shelf and pursue other interests or concerns. But then when they finally do encounter Christ in the afterlife, they turn out they didn't really have a faith at all. And Jesus says, "Depart from me, I never knew you." But the wise virgins or bridesmaids represents the Christian who has a living faith in Jesus Christ that sustains him and her through all things. An example of this can be seen in how the COVID-19 epidemic has closed our churches for a long season, now going on 2 months, and it hasn't ended yet. Who knows when we'll be allowed back to St. Paul's? Certainly it won't be before middle of June. So April, May, June, that's 3 months at least. But when we are finally allowed back, I'm sure there will be those who are eagerly ready to return and will be faithful as always. But it may be tempting for some, I don't know, but it may be tempting for some not to attend church regularly after this, for they will have been in the habit of just staying home on Sunday morning these many months. And they may be tempted to just say, well, they could be good Christians at home on Sundays, just like they were during the COVID-19 epidemic. So we have wise Christians who keep the faith, and we have weak Christians who do not keep the faith. The story goes, when someone had been baptized by immersion in the Episcopal Church on our foreign mission field, the man was asked about his baptism, to which he replied, "It's all right, but you can't hang around the river too long." And so baptism is not an end to itself, nor is confirmation for that matter. But it must be ratified in our heart by a spiritual baptism and a spiritual confirmation as well, a conversion of the heart. St. Clement of Alexandria, around 200 AD, once said of Christ coming into his own life, "He changed sunset into sunrise." And so a true faith, we make our conversion of a heart real by deliberately choosing at some point of our lives to follow the Lord, to cause our old lives to reach a sunset and choose a new life to dawn in our lives and become new people in Jesus Christ. As Philippians 1:6 says, "He who hath begun a good work in you will perform it, will complete it." He will complete it in our lives if we give him a chance. And so we need to take heed. We need to examine ourselves to see if we're in fellowship with Jesus Christ. And in the words of a prayer in the prayer book, that we show forth in our lives what we profess with our lips. A Jewish rabbi has written, "You Christians possess one advantage over us. When we use the word God, our listeners have a somewhat vague conception in their mind of righteousness and power combined in a being who fills the universe. But when you Christians employ that word, your hearers think immediately of the figure of Jesus of Nazareth." And so, my friends, we serve a living God and a real person, Jesus Christ, who died but who then rose again. We serve a risen, living Savior who has caused us to have new life and here in our lives below as well. 19th century Methodist bishop and missionary to India, E. Stanley Jones, once said, "Jesus came not only to get men into heaven, but to get heaven into men." Jesus came not only to get men out of hell, but to get hell and the devil and hell's curse out of men. The question is, though, again, do we have an authentic faith in Jesus Christ? Do we have our facts straight about Jesus and God so we're not worshiping an unknown God but the living God? An illustration. I'm reminded of these little known facts and events in our nation's history. Thomas Ayers, in his book, "That's Not in My American History Book," writes, and I quote him, "If an Englishman wrote our national anthem, would it be asking too much to believe that a Yankee wrote Dixie? And if you believe that, could it be possible a Southerner wrote the music to the battle hymn of the Republic?" But it's all true. Some of America's most cherished music came to us along some very unlikely paths. Almost everyone knows that Francis Scott Key wrote the words to the Star Spangled Banner, our national anthem. However, few are aware of the fact that Englishman John Stafford Smith wrote the music. Now, the Englishman did not set out to write an anthem for the United States, a nation with which his nation, England, would fight in the War of 1812. But Smith originally wrote the tune for a London social club. He had no way of knowing it would become a religious hymn and later the national anthem of the United States and in commemoration of his native England's defeat in a battle in the War of 1812. If an Englishman wrote the national anthem, though, then is it possible to convince a Southerner that a Yankee wrote Dixie? Dixie, the song has endured for more than a century as the national anthem of the South and the Confederate States of America. But it was actually written by a New York song and dance man, Dan D. Emmett, in 1860. What was his inspiration? It was not those old cotton fields back home, and Emmett definitely was not born on a frosty morning in Dixieland. He was born in Ohio and penned Dixie while sitting in his New York City hotel room. Emmett performed the song on stage in New York, and it became a popular song in the months prior to the outbreak of the Civil War. With the beginning of hostilities, Confederate soldiers adopted the song as their own. And ironically, the song was one of Abraham Lincoln's favorite songs. As for the music for the Battle Hymn of the Republic, it originally was composed as a religious hymn by a Southern songwriter named William Staff. It became the favorite marching hymn, though, of Union soldiers during the Civil War. The inspirational words of the Battle Hymn of the Republic were written by a Northerner, though, Julia Ward Howe, who composed the words after she saw Union soldiers in Washington, D.C., marching to the music of Southerner William Staff's hymn. Unquote, Thomas Ayers, and that's not in my history book. And in the words of Jack Palance in the old 1980s TV show, Believe It or Not, Believe It or Not. The moral is always have your facts straight. And always, and spiritually speaking, have your facts straight about Jesus Christ, or you will indeed be worshiping an unknown God. But Romans 10 declares, say not in thine heart, who shall ascend into heaven and bring Christ down? Or who shall descend into the deep to bring Christ up? But the living word Christ is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. Some years ago, the story goes, there was an Anglican church at the southwest coast of England. The church had been ruined by a hurricane. The church survived, but the steeple was destroyed. The congregation decided they just could not rebuild the steeple. They just could not afford it. But one day, a representative of the British Admiralty came to the rector, the pastor of the church, and the representative said, do you intend to reconstruct the church steeple? And the minister explained why they could not. It was just too expensive for the little congregation. To which the representative of the British Navy then replied, well, if you do not rebuild the church, then we will. For you see, the spire on that church is a landmark by which our ships steer their course. The moral is, the church is a landmark by which we Christians steer our course. If we try to endure in the church Jesus Christ has given us, the Lord Jesus will help us to endure. And we will be his forever. And if we endure in that baptism and remain faithful to the church, God's covenant people, God will reward us. To conclude then today, then may the Lord Jesus bless us and keep us always in his care. And may we be strengthened in our lives through this service and ever recommit our lives to Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray. And now to him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before his Father's throne with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior Jesus Christ, be all honor and glory, dominion and power, both now and evermore. Amen. The doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you, give you his peace now and forevermore. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. This is Doug Puckett saying goodbye, and until next time, And God willing, we hope someday soon to see your faces as you have seen being seeing mine. Good day.